Right. In this session, we will try to discuss about articulated pelvis. The literal meaning of pelvis is nothing but basin. Pelvis is Latin word. The meaning of pelvis is nothing but basin. See, it is looking like basin. But here aperture is there. This aperture will be closed by pelvic and urogenital diaphragm so that it appears as basin. Right? That's what they given the name as pelvis. See, this pelvis is formed by anterolaterally hip bone, posteriorly here sacrum and coccyx. That means sacrococcygeal vertebrae posteriorly, anterolaterally hip bone. Right? See, these bones articulated with one another and forms bony ring. This bony ring, what we are calling bony pelvis. See, posterolaterally there is a joint between the ilium and sacrum. This joint, what we are calling sacroiliac joint. Right? So here also sacroiliac joint. This sacroiliac joint is plane type of synovial joint. Then here in the anterior part, these two pubic bones articulated with one another and forms symphysis pubis. Symphysis pubis is secondary cartilaginous type of joint. Right? Now we are dividing the pelvis into greater pelvis and lesser pelvis. How? Here one margin is there. This is the margin. This margin what we are calling pelvic brim or pelvic inlet. This is bounded from posterior to anterior side. This is promontory. Promontory is nothing but anterior projected margin of body of first sacral vertebra, what we are calling promontory. Then this is ala. Here costal element and transverse element of first sacral vertebrae united and forms one triangular shaped mass of bone. This triangular shaped mass of bone, what we are calling ala. So ala having anterior margin and posterior margin. This anterior margin will forms the part of the pelvic brim. Then what is this? This is arcuate line. And what is this eminence? Here the fusion part of ilium and pubis. So what we can call this? Iliopubic eminence. Right? So iliopubic eminence. Then what is this crest? This is bony crest is there. This bony crest, what we are calling pectin pubis or pectinate line. Right? Then here, actually this is pubic tubercle, and here one crest is there. This crest, what we are calling pubic crest. Then what will be there in the center? Symphysis pubis. These are all the structures will form the pelvic brim. Let me tell you one more time. Promontory, anterior margin of ala, arcuate line, iliopubic eminence, pectin pubis, pubic crest, upper margin of symphysis pubis. If you come from anterior to posterior side, upper margin of symphysis pubis, pubic crest, pectin pubis, iliopubic eminence, arcuate line, anterior margin of ala and promontory. Right? Let me introduce one more word. Pubic crest, pectinate line and arcuate line. These structures unitedly what we are calling linea terminalis. So if you want to say simply, pelvic brim formed by linea terminalis, ala of the sacrum, promontory of the sacrum. These structures will form the pelvic brim. This pelvic brim separates the greater pelvis into lesser pelvis. Actually, the part of the pelvis which is present above the pelvic brim, this is greater pelvis. The part of the pelvis which is present below the pelvic brim is lesser pelvis or propelvis. This greater pelvis we can also call as false pelvis. Right? Then here this is pelvic cavity. This is pelvic cavity. This pelvic cavity bounded posteriorly by sacrum and coccyx. Right? Then laterally by, see here, this is lateral part. This laterally by pelvic surface of ilium and ischium. Right? Then anteriorly, see, this is anterior part. Okay? See, this is anterior part. This anterior part is formed by symphysis pubis, body of the pubis and two rami of pubis, this one and this one. Right? So anterior boundary of pelvic cavity, symphysis pubis, body of the pubis, ramus of the pubis, right, on both sides. Right? So these are the structures which are forming the boundaries of pelvic cavity. Now we know what are all the structures which forms the pelvic brim and what are all the structures which forms the boundaries of pelvic cavity. Now we'll see pelvic outlet. Actually this is pelvic inlet or pelvic brim, and here we are going to see pelvic outlet. See, this is pelvic outlet. Pelvic outlet bounded posteriorly by coccyx, that means tip of the coccyx here, right? Coccyx is not there, but here coccyx will be present. So tip of the coccyx posteriorly, and anteriorly lower margin of symphysis pubis. Then anterolaterally, what is this? Conjoined ischiopubic ramus. Conjoined ischiopubic ramus. This is conjoined ischiopubic ramus on both sides. Then laterally, what is there? Ischial tuberosity. This is ischial tuberosity. Then posterolaterally, what will be present? Here there will be one ligament which is stretching from, or which is extending from ischial tuberosity. See, this is ischial tuberosity and this is sacrum. So in between the ischial tuberosity and sacrum, there will be one ligament like this, right? So this ligament on both sides, this ligament, what we are calling sacrotuberous ligament. So this is sacrotuberous ligament. So if you observe, it is appearing as diamond shape. This is outlet. Outlet is diamond shape, bounded posteriorly by tip of the coccyx, anteriorly by inferior margin of symphysis pubis, anterolaterally conjoined ischiopubic ramus, laterally ischial tuberosity, and posterolaterally sacrotuberous ligament. Right? Now we know different boundaries of pelvic inlet, pelvic cavity, and pelvic outlet. Right? Now we will discuss one by one what is greater pelvis, what is lesser pelvis, and what are the different boundaries, and what are the pelvimetry mainly. That we will discuss. See, here this is greater pelvis, the part of the pelvis which is present above the pelvic brim. This is greater pelvis. Greater pelvis formed by, what is this fossa? Iliac fossa. What is this part of the sacrum? Ala. So ala and iliac fossa forms the greater pelvis, right? Actually greater pelvis is false pelvis. Why we are calling this as false pelvis? Here posteriorly bony boundary is there, but anteriorly there is no bony boundary. Anteriorly there will be abdominal wall, is it? So posteriorly only bony boundary is there. That's what this pelvis, what we are calling false pelvis. In the greater pelvis, we have to see few diameters. Even though they are not giving any reliable guidance for the pelvic cavity capacity, still we will try to see what are those measurements. The measurement or the diameter which is extending from the anterior superior iliac spine of one hip bone to anterior superior iliac spine of another hip bone. So this diameter, what we are calling interspinous diameter, right? Usually it is about 25 centimeters. Then one more diameter we have to see. See here, this is iliac crest, right? 5 centimeters from the anterior superior iliac spine, here you can find one tubercle. This tubercle, what we are calling tubercle of iliac crest, right? Of course, this side also you can find tubercle of iliac crest. If you take measurement from tubercle of this iliac crest to tubercle of this iliac crest, that means in between the two tubercles of iliac crest, this diameter is intercrestal diameter, right? This intercrestal diameter, it is around 26 centimeters to 27.5 centimeters, right? So this is about greater pelvis, right? Now we will see pelvic inlet. This is pelvic inlet. Margins we have already seen, right? Let me tell you one more time. Promontory, anterior margin of ala, arcuate line, pectine pubis, and this is pubic crest, right? Let me introduce one more word here. Linea terminalis is nothing but arcuate line, pectinate line, and pubic crest. These structures unitedly what we can call linea terminalis. Then we have to keep it in anatomical position to see the different measurements. See, how we have to keep it in anatomical position? If we keep the pelvis like this, this is not anatomical position, right? This is wrong. How we have to keep? You have to tilt it like this, right? What is this? Anterior superior iliac spine. And what is this? Symphysis pubis. These two should be in the same coronal plane. If you want to keep it in anatomical position very easily, you do one thing. this is anterior superior relaxment, and this is symphysis pubis. These two should be in the same coronal plane, right? So how will you keep, take the pelvis and touch the anterior superior relaxments and symphysis pubis to the wall, right? Like this, right? Then you turn it towards the examiner and show this. This is only anatomical position. That means anterior superior relaxment and symphysis pubis should be in same coronal plane. Then here what will be there? Coccyx. Coccyx is not there here, but imagine here coccyx is there. Just make a line from the coccyx to the upper margin of symphysis pubis. Both will be in the same plane. Then another factor is just make the horizontal line from the promontory, right? And measure the distance between this line and the symphysis pubis. This measurement will be around 9 centimeters. These are the different measurements and different factors to keep it in anatomical position. If we keep it in anatomical position, how the pelvic inlet is directing? It is sloping downwards and forwards. Is it or not? It is sloping downwards and forwards. Right? How? Let me draw. Here, this is promontory. Right? And what is this? Here, symphysis pubis. Right? Now, if you make line from promontory to the upper margin of symphysis pubis, this is pelvic inlet, right? So this is pelvic inlet. Then if you take the horizontal line, actually this is horizontal line. Now we are extending horizontal line forwards, and we are also extending pelvic inlet, right? Here it forms 50 to 60 degrees angle, right? So this angle is 50 to 60 degrees, right? So this is symphysis pubis, and this is sacrum, and this is coccyx, right? So this is pelvic inlet. Now we will see what are the different diameters we have to take along the pelvic inlet. Measurements of pelvis, what we are calling pelvimetry. This pelvimetry is very important obstetrically, forensically, anthropologically, and radiologically. That's what we have to take the measurements of pelvis. This process what we are calling pelvimetry, right? So first we will take anteroposterior diameter of pelvic inlet. That means from the upper margin of symphysis pubis to the promontory or middle of the promontory. This measurement what we are calling anteroposterior diameter or anatomical conjugate. This anatomical conjugate, in case of males it is around 10 centimeters, but in case of females it is around 10.5 to 11 centimeters. Then oblique diameter from here to here. That means from the sacroiliac joint of one side to the iliopubic eminence of opposite side. This diameter what we are calling oblique diameter. This diameter what we are calling oblique diameter. Right? This oblique diameter in case of males is 11 centimeters, but in case of females it is around 12 to 12.5 centimeters. Then transverse diameter. Wherever there is highest diameter, there we have to take the transverse diameter. This transverse diameter in case of males it is around 12.5 centimeters, but in case of females it is 13 centimeters. Here we have to remember that transverse diameter of pelvic inlet is more than the remaining two diameters. Along with these three diameters, we have to take three more diameters in case of females, because these are obstetrically important. What are those? They are anteroposterior diameters only, but points will be different. What are those points? We will see now. Here, anatomical conjugate we know, upper margin of symphysis pubis to the promontory. Then another one is here. What is this? This is middle of the symphysis pubis. Is it or not? This is middle of the symphysis pubis to the promontory. Middle of the symphysis pubis to the promontory. This diameter what we are calling obstetrical conjugate. What is this? Obstetrical conjugate. this obstetrical conjugate is 0.5 centimeters less than the anatomical conjugate, right? So this diameter, what we are calling obstetrical conjugate, right? Then one more conjugate, it is from the inferior margin. What is this? This is inferior margin of symphysis pubis, from the inferior margin of symphysis pubis to the promontory, right? So this measurement, what we are calling diagonal conjugate. What is it? Diagonal conjugate. This diagonal conjugate is 1.5 centimeter more than the anatomical conjugate. Then one more conjugate is there. Even though it will not give reliable guide, but it will give one crude idea. What is that conjugate? The conjugate or the diameter which is extending from the symphysis pubis to the spine of fifth lumbar vertebrae. Here I put fifth lumbar vertebrae, spine of fifth lumbar vertebrae to the symphysis pubis. This measurement, what we are calling external conjugate. This external conjugate is 19 centimeters, right? But if you want to get the anatomical conjugate from the external conjugate, what you have to do? You have to take the external conjugate and you have to minus 9 centimeters, right? So the total conjugate average is 19 centimeters. If you minus 9, you will get the anatomical conjugate, that is 10 centimeters. These are the different conjugates. Let me show you in the diagram. This is promontory, right? So what is this? This is anatomical conjugate or pelvic inlet. This is middle of the posterior aspect of the symphysis pubis. Now from here to promontory, we are making the line. So what is this? This is obstacle conjugate, right? Then one more conjugate, which is extending from inferior margin of symphysis pubis to the promontory. So this is inferior margin of symphysis pubis and this is promontory. We are making the line like this. Diagonal conjugate. So this is anatomical conjugate, this is obstacle conjugate, and this is diagonal conjugate, right? So these are the different conjugates. Now we have to see the axis of the pelvic inlet. Axis of the pelvic inlet means what? This is pelvic inlet, is it or not? This is directing downwards, forwards, is it? Here, if you take the central point of pelvic inlet, if you extend it up and down, you will get the axis of pelvic inlet. See here, this is axis of pelvic inlet. This axis of pelvic inlet meets the middle of the coccyx in the posterior aspect, and in the anterior aspect it meets the umbilicus. So this axis, what we are calling axis of pelvic inlet. Actually this axis of pelvic inlet represents the axis of uterus. That means here uterus will be present. The long axis of uterus coincides with the axis of pelvic inlet, right? So that is about axis of pelvic inlet, right? So these are all the different measurements of pelvic inlet. Now we'll see what are the different shapes of pelvic inlet. See, if you observe here, this is pelvic inlet. Okay, observe here and tell me what is the shape of it. Posterior it is wider, anterior it is narrower. So it is looking like conventional heart. It is appearing like this, is it or not? So posteriorly wider, anteriorly narrower. So it is appearing like heart of playing cards. If you found pelvic inlet in this shape, this pelvis, what we are calling android, android pelvis, right? Then if you observe like ovoid, if you observe like oval in shape like this, this pelvis, what we are calling gynecoid type. Usually around 50% of the females will be having the this type of pelvis. Then another type of pelvis, in those individuals we can found pelvic inlet in this shape. That means anterior posterior diameter is more than the transverse diameter, right? So this pelvis, what we are calling anthropoid. What is this? Anthropoid. Anthropoid, right? This is gynecoid. right? Then another type of pelvis will be there. In that pelvis, pelvic indent will be like this. Transverse diameter is more than the anteroposterior diameter. That means too much more, right? So it is looking like flat, a flat pelvis. This pelvis what we are calling platyploid pelvis. So this is android pelvis. It is looking like heart shape. This is android type. If it is oval, gynecoid type. If it is anteroposterior diameter is more than the transverse diameter, this is anthropoid. If the transverse diameter is more than the anteroposterior diameter, that is platyploid. Right? So these are the different shapes of the pelvic inlet. If the female having gynecoid type of pelvis, she will be having a less risk during normal parturition. That is about different shapes of pelvic inlet. Now we'll see measurements of pelvic cavity. Here also we have to take anteroposterior diameter, transverse diameter and oblique diameter. So here anteroposterior diameter from where to where you have to take, from the middle of the symphysis pubis to the middle of the third sacral vertebrae. This measurement is anteroposterior diameter. Middle of the symphysis pubis, middle of the third piece of sacrum, right? So this measurement is anteroposterior diameter. The average anteroposterior diameter in case of females is around 13 centimeters. This is 13 centimeters, right? Then another diameter is oblique diameter. From where to where you have to take, what is this joint? Sacroiliac joint. From the inferior margin of sacroiliac joint to the obturator membrane or center of the obturator membrane. That means like this, we have to take oblique diameter in the pelvic cavity. That means center of the obturator membrane. Actually here, this is obturator foramen, right? Obturator foramen covered by obturator membrane. Inferior part of sacroiliac joint of one side to the middle of the obturator membrane of opposite side. Right? So if you take that measurement, that is oblique diameter. Oblique diameter in case of females, it is around 13.1 centimeters. Another diameter is transverse diameter. Okay, wherever there is highest diameter, there we have to take. It will be around 12.5 centimeters in case of female pelvis. Here in the pelvic cavity, oblique diameter is more. Right? Then here one more measurement we have to take in the pelvic cavity. See, this is ischial spine. This is also another ischial spine. If you take the transverse diameter in between the two ischial spines, that is plane of lesser diameter. This is very narrowest part of the pelvic cavity. The most of the obstructed levers takes place at this level only. Right? So that is about measurements or pelvimetry of pelvic cavity. Now we'll see pelvic outlet. See, this is pelvic outlet. Right? In the pelvic outlet also, we have to take anteroposterior diameter, transverse diameter and oblique diameter. Right? First, if you take anteroposterior diameter, actually from the tip of the coccyx to the inferior margin of symphysis pubis, this measurement we have to take. But mostly, we will take the apex of sacrum to the inferior margin of symphysis pubis, because coccyx is movable. That's what we will take measurement from the apex of sacrum to the inferior margin of symphysis pubis, right? So this is anteroposterior diameter, right? Then transverse diameter from the inner surface of ischium. This is inner surface of ischium, and this is also inner surface of ischium. That means from inner surface of one ischium to inner surface of another ischium. This is transverse diameter, right? Then oblique diameter, from where to where we have to take. See here, this is conjoint ramus, is it or not? It is formed by inferior ramus of pubis and the ramus of ischium. This ramus what we are calling conjoint ramus, right? At the junction of pubic ramus and ischial ramus, we put one point and another point. Here I told you there will be one ligament which is extending from sacrum to the ischial tuberosity, is it? Like this, right? So from here to here, we have to take one measurement. See, at the junction of ramus of pubis and the ramus of ischium, and another point is at the middle of the sacrotuberous ligament. This is oblique diameter, right? Now we'll see what are the average diameters of pelvic outlet. Anteroposterior diameter is around 12.5 centimeters in case of females and 8 centimeters in case of males. Then obliquity diameter 11.8 centimeters in case of females, 10 centimeters in case of males. Then transverse diameter. Transverse diameter is 11.8 centimeters in case of females and 8.5 centimeters in case of males. Right? So these are the different measurements or pelvimetry of pelvic outlet. Now we'll see what is the plane of pelvic outlet. Actually, pelvic outlet is not in the same plane. See here, this is also pelvic outlet and this is also pelvic outlet. These are not in the same plane. This anterior part of the pelvic outlet is sloping downwards and backwards. The posterior part of the pelvic outlet is directed downwards and forwards. Right? But for practical purpose, we will take the pelvic outlet from the tip of the coccyx to the inferior margin of symphysis pelvis. Let me draw here. See, this is tip of coccyx and this is inferior margin of symphysis pelvis. Now we are making the line. This line is plane of pelvic outlet. Right? So this is plane of pelvic inlet and this is plane of pelvic outlet. In between the plane of pelvic outlet and the horizontal line, here it is making angle. Is it? It is around 10 to 15 degrees. Then we will see the axis of pelvic outlet. Axis of pelvic outlet means what? Axis of pelvic inlet, how we have taken from the center point of pelvic inlet, we are extending the line upwards and downwards. In the same manner, in the pelvic outlet also, we are keeping the one point here in the center. Is it? We are extending upwards and downwards. Is it? So, this one, actually, this is center point, right? If you make the line like this, along the central part of pelvic outlet, this is central axis of pelvic outlet. This central axis of pelvic outlet coincides the central axis of vagina. Central axis of inlet coincides the long axis of uterus, and the central axis of pelvic outlet coincides the long axis of vagina. That means here uterus will be like this and vagina will be like this. Is it? This is vagina and this is uterus. So these are the different measurements in the pelvic outlet. Right? Now we have to see one more axis, that is axis of pelvic cavity. Axis of pelvic cavity. Now we have drawn all these lines. Right? So if you keep the central point of all these lines, central point of all these lines, and if you meet, what you'll get? You'll get the central axis of pelvic cavity. So this is central axis of pelvic cavity. This central axis of pelvic cavity concave anteriorly. Is it? This is concave anteriorly and it is parallel to the sacrococcygeal curvature. Is it or not? See, it is parallel to the sacrococcygeal curvature through which fetal head will be passing during parturition. That's what this axis we can also call it as axis of birth canal. This upper part of the axis passes downwards and backwards and coincides with the axis of pelvic inlet up to the ischial spine. Then the lower part, it will be coincides with the axis of pelvic outlet. So this is axis of pelvic cavity or axis of birth canal. Through this axis, fetal head will be passing during parturition. Clear? So this is about pelvimetry. In the pelvic inlet, which diameter is more? Transverse diameter is more. In the pelvic cavity, which diameter is more? Obliquity diameter is more. And in the pelvic outlet, which diameter is more? Anterior posterior diameter is more. Right? Actually, during delivery or during parturition, suboccipital brachmatic diameter of fetal head, first it fixes transversely at the pelvic inlet because transverse diameter of pelvic inlet is more. Then suboccipital brachmatic diameter will be rotates like this in the pelvic cavity because obliquity diameter in the pelvic cavity is more. Is it? So it will be rotating like this. Then at the pelvic outlet, that axis will be anteroposteriorly. In this manner, head is rotating and coming out through the vagina. Right? So that is about pelvimetry. Right? Now we'll see what are the main differences between the male and female pelvis. See here, If you take male pelvis, it is heavier and muscular markings which are present over these bones are very prominent. But in case of females, it is lighter and muscular markings are less prominent. Then iliac fossa is more concave in case of males. Actually, this is iliac fossa. This iliac fossa is more concave in case of males than the females. So, in case of females, this fossa is very shallow. Then, anterior superior iliac spine, inverted in case of males. But in case of females, it may be everted or projecting anteriorly. Then, ischiopubic rami is thicker. Here, this is ischiopubic ramus. In case of males, it is very thicker and the inferior margin is everted. See here, this inferior margin is everted. So, this pelvis is belongs to male. But in case of females, this ischiopubic ramus is very thin. The lower border is not everted due to weak attachment of crus clitoris. Actually, in case of males, very strong attachment of crura of the penis. That's what it is everted. But in case of females, this will give attachment to the crus clitoris. Then, here we will take transverse diameter of two margins of acetabulum, like this. Then, the same diameter, if you take the anterior margin of acetabular margin to the symphysis pubis. This is almost similar. But in case of females, what will happen? This diameter is more than the acetabular diameter. That means, this acetabular diameter is less than the diameter which is extending from the anterior margin of acetabulum to the symphysis. That means, what is happening here? After attaining the puberty, this pubic bone will be growing more. That's what this anterior part becomes enlarged. And at the same time, if you observe here, this is transverse diameter of body of first sacral vertebrae. And this is the ala. See, the transverse diameter of body of first sacral vertebrae is more than the length of the ala. Is it? But in case of females, this diameter and this diameter will be similar. That means, what is happening here? After puberty, pubis is growing, so that anteriorly transverse diameter is increasing and this lateral mass or the ala is growing laterally, so that anteriorly and posteriorly the transverse diameter is increasing. That's what in case of females, it becomes almost oval shaped pelvic cavity. Then obturator foramen. This is obturator foramen. In case of females, this obturator foramen is smaller and triangular. This obturator foramen is smaller and triangular. But in case of males, the obturator foramen is oval and larger. Oval and larger. So, this is male pelvis. Clear? Then, preauricular sulcus. Actually, here, this is auricular surface of the ileum. Right? In front of the auricular surface of the ileum, you can find one sulcus. That sulcus, what we are calling preauricular sulcus. This preauricular sulcus in case of male pelvis, you can see very scarcely. But in case of females, it is very prominent because ventral sacroiliac ligament will be attached and it will be stretched so that there will be formation of groove. That groove, what we are calling preauricular sulcus. In case of parasomians, that means the mother who given birth to the babies, in those individuals, that preauricular sulcus will be furthermore prominent. So, these are the general differences between the male and female pelvis. Then, pelvic inlet. Actually, all diameters, that means anterior posterior diameter, transverse diameter, oblique diameter, all diameters of female pelvis is more than the male pelvis. Then, we will see the pelvic cavity. Actually, here we have to take two cones. Here, we will take two cones. One cone is longer cone and another cone is shorter cone. Now what we have to take is short section of long cone and long section of short cone. That means if you take this part, how it will be? It will be like this, right? But here it will be like this. This is male pelvis and this is female pelvis. Male pelvis is long section of short cone. That means the shape of the male's pelvis is long section of short cone. But in case of females, short section of long cone. That means if you take section like this, coronal section, and if you observe, in case of males, it will be like this. That means if you take the at the level of ischium, it will be like this. It is tapered downwards. But in case of females, it is straight. It will be vertically present. So it is cylindrical, but it is conical. This is cylindrical and this is conical in shape. So in case of males, pelvic cavity is longer and more conical in shape. But in case of females, it is shorter and cylindrical. That's what female pelvis represents, the short section of long cone, and male pelvis is long section of short cone. Right? Then symphysis pubis is elongated in case of males. See here, the symphysis pubis is elongated in case of males, but in case of females, the symphysis pubis is very short. That means it will be, the symphysis pubis will be very shorter or very less length in case of females. Right? Then the vertical growth of ischium is more in case of males. That means this growth is more in case of males than the transverse growth of pubis. So in case of females, transverse growth of the pubis will be more and the vertical growth of the ischium will be less. That's what, if you take one index, ischiopubic index, the length of the pubis we have to take, this is the length of the pubis, and we have to take the length of the ischium. So we have to express length of the pubis by length of the ischium into 100. You will get some result, right? That result, in case of males, it is less than 90. But in case of females, the ischiopubic index is more than 90, right? Then kilotic line. What is kilotic line or chilotic line? Anything you can write. Kilotic line or chilotic line. Spelling is CHILOTIC. Kilotic line or chilotic line. We have to extend the line from the iliopubic eminence to the anterior margin of auricular surface. See, this is auricular surface. Then it extends up to the iliac crest. Right? So this line, what we are calling kilotic line. If you divide the into anterior part and posterior part, the anterior segment of this line is shorter in case of males, but in case of females, the anterior segment is longer than the posterior segment. So these are the differences in the pelvic cavity between the male and females. Then pelvic outlet. See, in the pelvic outlet also, almost all diameters will be less in case of males, more in case of females. Actually, 1 inch less in case of males than the females, right? And here, one more thing we have to discuss here. This is pubic angle. The angle between the two conjoined ischiopubic ramus, what we are calling pubic angle. This is pubic angle, right? So this pubic angle in case of males, it is 50 to 60 degrees. But in case of females, it is around 80 to 90 degrees. It will be more. Why? Because of wider pelvis. Then, what is this notch? What is this notch here? Greater sciatic notch. This is greater sciatic notch. Right? This greater sciatic notch is narrower in case of males. It is wider in case of females. So, the angle and depth of the greater sciatic notch in case of males is narrower than the females. The angle is around 50.5 degrees in case of males. The same measurement or the same angle here, this is angle will be present now. This angle is 74.5 degrees in case of females, because sacrum and coccyx are pushed backwards, right? So that this angle will be more. Then what are the other differences? See, this is ischial spine. This is also ischial spine. These ischial spines are interned or inverted in case of males, but in case of females, it is everted or outturned. It is projected outwards. In case of females, it is projected inwards in case of males. Then if you take the differences in the sacrum, the length is longer and narrower in case of males. But in case of females, it is shorter and wider, right? Then one index we can see here, sacral index. That sacral index expressed as maximum width by maximum length into 100. You will get one result. That result is sacral index. That sacral index in case of males, it is 105. But in case of females, sacral index is 115. Then you will see the curvature of sacrum. Actually, curvature of sacrum in case of males, it is uniformly curved. See, this is curvature of sacrum. It is uniformly curved. But in case of females, it is flatter in the upper part and in the lower part, it is abruptly curved. Actually, the pelvic surface bend twice in case of females. In between the second and third sacral segment and fourth and fifth sacral segments, you can see abrupt bend. Then another difference is in the coccyx. What is the difference? Coccyx will be immobile in case of males. But in case of females, it is more mobile to facilitate the accommodation of head of the fetus. Then sacroiliac joint permits limited movements here. See this? This is sacroiliac joint. This sacroiliac joint permits very less movements in case of males. But in case of females, this joint permits rotatory movements during pregnancy due to the relaxation of pelvic ligaments. So these are the different differences between the male and female pelvis. Then we will see the classification of pelvis. Actually, one classification we have already seen. This is the classification based on the shape of the pelvis. Is it? If it is heart shaped, that is android. If it is oval shaped, that is gynecoid. If it is anterior posterior diameter is increased, that is anthropoid. If it is transverse diameter is more, that is platypoid. This classification based on the shape of pelvic inlet. Then according to the measurements of pelvic inlet, we are dividing into different types. What are those? First one is dolichopelic. In that, anterior posterior diameter is more than the transverse diameter. Actually, it assumes the anthropoid shape. So what is this? Dolichopelic. Dolichopelic. Then another type is transverse diameter is more than the anterior posterior diameter, about 1 centimeter only. Transverse diameter is more than the anterior posterior diameter, but not much, only 1 centimeter. This type of pelvis, what we are calling mesiatophilic. Mesiatophilic. Right? Then another type is transverse diameter is more than the anterior posterior diameter. But how much? 1.1 to 2.9 centimeters. Right? So this type of pelvis, what we are calling brachypelic. Brachypelic. Right? Then another one. It resembles our platyploid. Transverse diameter is too much more than the anterior posterior diameter. Okay, so how much? It is 3 centimeters or more than 3 centimeters. That type of pelvis, what we are calling platypelic. Platypelic. So these are the different types of pelvis. Now we'll see what are the applied aspects. When difficulty of the labor will be happening. See, here one conjugate is there. What is that conjugate? This is obstacle conjugate. This obstacle conjugate, if it is less than 10 centimeters, she may be having the risk of difficulty in the labor. Then, if the distance between the two ischial spine, see this is one ischial spine and this is another ischial spine. If the distance between the two ischial spine is less than 8.5 centimeters, here also there will be risk. Then, when the distance between the two ischial tuberosities, see this is one ischial tuberosity and this is another ischial tuberosity. If the distance between the two ischial tuberosities is less than 8 centimeters, there will be risk. When the fetal head is present above the pelvic inlet, even after the onset of labor, there also there will be risk. Okay, so these are the different applied aspects. Right, so I hope you understood. That's it for this session.